Praise God and welcome to Celebration Pulse in conversation as we continue to delve deeper into the word of the year, watch and speak. We have had some very insightful sessions, Pastor Precious, with Pastor Sylvan, with Pastor Audrey, and today I'm joined by Pastor Givemore Mushayi, who is one of our associate pastors at Celebration Church Johannesburg, as we engage with the word that God has given us as Celebration Church Ministries in 2020. We are halfway through the year. We are past the halfway point, and God has really been ministering to us. We hope you'll be encouraged. We hope you'll be motivated, and we hope that you'll finish the year strong. So welcome, Pastor Givemore.
Thank you, Dr. Makoni. It's really a privilege to be a part of this conversation. And yes, I've been blessed by the previous conversation we have had on this platform.
Excellent. We really are honored to get your insights as we reflect on it. So shall we just begin by prayer? Holy Spirit, we welcome you to help us, give us insights, give us revelation. Lead us as we communicate, as we share, as we search the word. May you superintend over our conversation for your glory. May you be honored, may be lifted up in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.
Amen.
So, Pastor Givemore, 2020, the year of pay, the year of the mouth, the year of speaking. Talk to us. What ministers to you from this word? Let's hear you.
Thank you, Dr. Makoni. You know, Doc, before I even go into the word, I just want to maybe say a few things on how the year began for me and for us. Mm-hmm. And, you know, when I'm just taking us back to January, you know, and January, everyone, the offices closed down, mm-hmm. and we come back to the offices, mm-hmm. early January.
Right.
So I'm just remembering this day when we just opened the office after the holidays. Mm-hmm. And one of my colleagues was coming back from the holidays. I'm mm-hmm. going to just tell a bit of a story about this colleague.
Sure. What happened. Go ahead. We love stories. Yes. So, we are Africans. We love storytelling.
Amen. So we just come back to the office, and she's and this colleague of mine, she's a lady, and she's coming in, and I'm just remembering that day, early January, when I was telling her, you know what, do you realize what has just happened? And I'm going to tell you the story just now. Mm-hmm. And my words to her was, do you realize how important the words we speak are? Mm-hmm. Is, you know, how important our declarations are? Mm-hmm. You know, and Pastor Tom, in the word of the year, was talking about the power of our declarations.
Right. Right.
Now, this is what has happened. You know, late 2019, mm-hmm. Two of our senior managers, mm-hmm. a gentleman and a lady, they were all diagnosed with some conditions right. that required major surgeries.
Yeah.
The gentleman was so afraid, mm-hmm. and he says, his words was, you know what, I'm so afraid that I will not come back out of this operation.
Wow.
And he was so afraid because of past histories. His father had died at a young age in his late 40s. Mm-hmm. Now he is in his late 40s. Mm-hmm. Now he's diagnosed with a condition that requires a major operation. Mm-hmm. And fear gripped him.
Yeah.
Now the other, who is this lady that I'm talking about, mm-hmm. also was diagnosed with a condition that also required major operation.
Right.
And I remember in late November, before they were all, these operations all happened
about the same time.
Mm-hmm. And I remember when I was speaking to her, and she was getting ready to go for an operation. And she was telling me, you know what, I'm very calm. Mm-hmm. Before, she was very anxious about many things.
Yeah.
But I think it was in September, she took a trip to France where she, kind of a pilgrimage trip. She's a Catholic. Yeah. Mm-hmm. She's Catholic, so she took a pilgrimage trip. And she came back and said, you know what, I'm very calm. And I'm not even worried about the operation anymore.
Right.
My mind is at peace. I know everything is going to go well.
So that there's a complete difference. One is in fear.
Yes.
And he is speaking negative things.
Yes.
And one is calm after a pilgrimage.
Yes.
Wow. Okay.
And so these two, they had a conversation. Mm-hmm. And the gentleman was asking about, why are you not afraid?
Mm-hmm.
He said, I am at peace because mm-hmm. I know that I'm going to go in there. I know that the Lord is with me and I'm going to come out of there.
Mm-hmm.
So this is just one of the operations that many and thousands of people are going through.
Yeah.
And I'm just going in and I'm going to come back.
Right.
Lo and behold, the two went into operations mm-hmm. right at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
And mid-December, mm-hmm. we received the message that the gentleman is no more.
Oh, so sorry about that.
And that really, when we received the word in January,
mm-hmm.
that then really hit me. I remembered how you were so afraid
mm-hmm.
and how you would vocalize his fears and say, you know what, I don't know if I'm going to come back.
So in reality, it's the power of words. So death and life, the Bible says, is in the power of our words. But not only that, the Bible also teaches that we can give room to the devil. So through fear and through believing a lie of the devil that says, this is the pattern, this is an iniquity in your family, this is how it works. So he actually gave room, he gave leverage to the devil by what he believed. And you know, there are so many believers who do exactly the same. The moment you are talking about something happens, they say, oh, you know, my father did this, my mother did this. It always happens in our family. So they then begin to believe the lie of the enemy rather than the word of God. And we are told, watch what you speak. Sometimes you have to be silent. Mm-hmm. So we need to be careful about what we say.
Absolutely.
It's so sad about that gentleman.
It's really, really sad. And all of us in the office, we believe that it was not his time.
Mm-hmm.
And but we see that most of the time the enemy tricks us to believe mm-hmm. the lie.
Yeah.
Because he knows and he understands that he is a defeated foe.
Yeah.
And he cannot do nothing.
Right.
But he then tricks us for us then to speak.
Yes.
Knowing that the power is in our words. Life and death is in the power of the tongue.
Yes.
So as we begin to speak whatever we speak, then it becomes a reality.
It authorizes him. It empowers him.
Absolutely.
So and I think that's a powerful insight, Pastor. To say, you said the devil is defeated. That's what the Bible says.
Yes.
So it's true. So he knows that he cannot operate against us because he's defeated. So he needs our cooperation.
Yes.
Just like if I were to put it another way, you know, demons and the forces of darkness have no legitimacy on earth. So they need a body to give them license to operate on earth.
Yes.
That's why you now have demon possession and all these kinds of things.
Yes.
So similarly, the devil knows that he is defeated.
Yes.
His words are not valid here on earth.
Mm.
But he needs a person on earth to give him permission. So when he lies and we buy into his lies and we vocalize those lies, we are now giving license and authority and power to his thoughts.
Yes.
So our words, when we begin to speak what the lies of the enemy as fact, when we believe them and we verbalize them, we are actually he's using us as a channel.
Yes.
To make room for him.
Yes.
Which is why the Bible says, do not give the devil any room.
Yes.
So we need to be careful what we say.
Absolutely.
Mm.
And I think this is exactly what Pastor Tom has been teaching us this year. I'm just going to read an excerpt from the Word of the Year. He says, our declarations of God's Word will be used powerfully to express his purposes and directions in this season. Isaiah 55 verse 11 says, so shall my word that goeth forth out of my mouth it shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I send it.
Amen.
And he says, he watches over his word to perform it, and it will not return to him void. So I think we have been challenged. I have been challenged that, you know what, we have to be careful what we say, what we speak, because what we speak rearranges or creates a reality in our lives.
So it's the creative force in the word.
There is a creative, yes, the word is powerful, it is living, it is active, it creates. You know, one of the famous or prominent preachers usually say that, you know, the spiritual world is as real as the physical world. So,
actually, I would change it a little bit. It's more real than the physical world.
Yes.
Because the physical world is born out of the spiritual world.
Absolutely. Yes. So the spiritual world is more real than the physical world. And just because we don't see what is happening in the spiritual world does not mean that it does not exist, and does not mean that nothing is happening. But what I'm getting from the word of the year is that the spiritual world is more real,
right,
and things are happening. And the only thing, our part in the happenings of the things in the spiritual world, is what we speak.
Yeah.
So what we speak therefore influences what then happens, what becomes a reality for us. So which is why it is very, very important for me and very, very important for us to speak the right things.
So true, so true.
So, and as I was just studying the word of the year and understanding what the direction that we are getting, I just want to read one part of the scripture in Psalm chapter 103, verse 20, which says, "Bless the Lord, you his angels, who excel in strength, who do his word, heeding to the voice of his word."
Right.
So what I got when from the word of the year is Pastor Tom was teaching us, you know, that we should be careful what we speak.
Right.
Life and death is in the power of the tongue.
Mm.
And that the word of God is so powerful, and it will accomplish what it's supposed to accomplish. It will not go out and come back. Now, as I read Psalm 103, what I'm getting here is that the angels are waiting to do the word of God.
Yes.
So in this spiritual realm that we're talking about,
right,
we have angels who are ready to enforce the word of God.
To execute on the word of God, right.
To execute it.
Yeah.
But our role is to give a voice to the word of God.
And so when the voice is given.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
When we give a voice to the word of God, then the angels are ready to execute. That the angels are ready to run. He has given us angels as ministering and spirits.
Yeah, that's what Hebrews says.
Yes.
And here is the thing, Pastor. I mean, many people have had this mistaken idea that we can command angels to do things. They say, oh, my angel, you are ministering spirits to me, so you minister to me. You go do this for me. You do. No, you don't. That scripture that you have just shared is very powerful, because they are ready to execute on the word of God.
Yeah.
But they want to hear the voice of the word.
Yes.
So they can either hear it directly as an instruction from the Father, or they can hear it as the saints begin to speak the word.
Yes.
When I declare the word, when I give voice to the word, the angels respond not to me, but they respond to the word, because that's their instruction.
Yes.
So when I as a believer begin to decree and speak the word,
yes,
I am employing the angels. When I am quiet and I'm not speaking the word of God, then it means I am keeping them unemployed.
Absolutely.
When I speak the word of the devil, because the demons are also fallen angels, they operate with the same principle.
Absolutely.
So when I believe the lie of the devil and I speak the word of the devil, I'm giving voice to that word.
Yes.
And I'm activating the demonic to operate.
Absolutely.
In my situation.
Absolutely.
Is that the reason why we were told to watch what we speak?
Absolutely. I just want you to take back. I know growing up, I'm looking for the right English word. But I'll try to paraphrase it in English.
Right.
I don't have the right English word.
No,
growing up, there was a phenomenon where you shouldn't talk something bad to somebody, then that bad thing will happen. And it was commonly known that you know, and those are kind of word cases. You know?
Yes, yeah. Mm-hmm.
When you speak something bad,
something negative. Yeah.
Something sometimes or jokingly,
like somebody you think you are joking and say, you know what you did for me, and you are going to die for it.
Exactly. That's what I'm trying to.
And then it so happens within weeks that person dies, and there are people who had that conversation.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So, you know, just looking at that, we see that, you know, like what you are saying, that the demons are also waiting for a word to come out of our mouth.
Yeah.
So that they can run with it and execute it.
Right.
As we know that demons are fallen angels.
Yeah.
They know the principle.
Yeah.
So it's either we're going to speak the word of the truth and the angels are going to run with it and execute it.
Right.
Or we're going to speak a lie, or we're going to speak negative. And the demonic entities are going to run with it.
Yeah.
And then we are surprised. Why are things happening? We don't realize it's because of what we have spoken, what we have vocalized. Maybe it's a fear, but when we vocalize it, it becomes a reality.
Yeah. Because you activate
the
spiritual world. So our words, for better or for worse, will activate the spiritual world. So it is important as believers that we are careful that we speak the word of God. Because when we speak the word of God, it activates the angels. If we speak the lies of the devil, then we activate the demonic.
Absolutely.
And it gives effect to that word. Because, you see, death and life are in the power of the tongue.
Yes. Amen. So, Doc, this word has been, it has been blessing me so much, given what I have experienced, what I have experienced at the office. And now I'm trying to, it's very difficult, you know, to maintain that testimony. Therefore, we have to be very careful. And Pastor Tommy has been actually been encouraging, pray that the Holy Spirit cut your tongue so that you speak the right word. It's very easy to speak a negative word to a child. It's very easy to speak a negative word to the circumstances that you are dealing with. But if the Holy Spirit does not help us, we find ourselves in this situation.
You know, before you move on, Pastor, they're just talking about the power of words. Not only is that the words we speak are powerful in the spirit realm in terms of the operation of the demonic or the angelic.
Yes.
But you remember Pastor Boning used to share that experiment, a Japanese experiment, where somebody had a microscope and they were speaking, when they spoke positive words to water, it was well orderly, the molecules, the whatever, the particles were in order. The moment they spoke death or harshly and so on, there was disorder, there was a crumbling.
Yeah.
So in other words, even creation responds to words.
Yes.
Just like a person, when you speak negative, somebody will wilt.
Yes.
If you speak positive, somebody will glimmer.
Yes.
So creation was created by the word, by word.
Yes.
You spoke things into existence.
Yes.
So words still are creative.
Yes.
And therefore we need to be careful what we are saying. Like you said, to our children, to our spouses, to our spouse, not spouses.
Right, yes.
To our businesses, to our jobs. There's some people right now in this COVID situation who are thinking, I am afraid, you know, I may be laid off and I may be this. You are giving voice to the enemy.
Yeah.
You are activating the demonic.
Yeah.
And you are causing your job to wilt.
Yeah.
From the insights that we're hearing from Pastor Givemore here, we need to set a guard over our mouth.
Yeah.
Watch your words.
Absolutely.
Yes, so go ahead.
Well, this is very, very exciting, Doc. I'm also really enjoying this conversation. There's one aspect that Pastor Tom also touched in the Word of the Year, which I would want us also to revisit. He says, although this is a year of God's favor, we will be required to speak forth that which we have seen and have come to know. We must be willing to call it into being. As we speak out and decree the word, the creative force of God will generate activity for the word to be established. That which is not will become into manifestation. What I got there, Doc, is that there are things that God has already done for us.
Yes.
But those things will not come into being unless and until we speak it for.
Right.
There are breakthroughs that God has already given us.
Yeah.
Right now as we speak. Maybe somebody you've been praying for your business, you've been praying for your marriage. That breakthrough has already been given.
Yeah.
But it will not come into being unless and until we begin to speak it forth.
So we need to speak it.
We need to speak it into being.
God who calls those things that be not though they were.
Absolutely.
We are like God, so we believe, therefore we speak. So we call forth into that which be not though it, that it may be.
Absolutely. Yes.
So we need to speak.
We need to speak.
So what are you speaking these days?
A lot of things. A lot of things. You know, coming from the decade of Ayin, ending in 2019, God has began to show me, or at the end of the decade of Ayin, there were so many things that I began to see. For example, I began to see that, you know what, there's some things that are undone, though, that are not finished in my life.
There's some unfinished business.
Unfinished business. And at the end of the decade of Ayin, one of the things was I was doing my master's degree for a very long time, which was not finished. And at the beginning of 2019, I was very agitated that I need this to be done. I need this to be finished. And that did happen. I managed to finish it in 2019.
Well done. Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you, Doc. And as I came into 2020, I began to look at some of the things in our organization where I work, some of the things that were not aligned, some of the things that were not in order.
Yeah.
And at the same agitation also was in me and saying, you know what, we need to make things happen and put things in proper place and in order. And that those are the things that I'm dealing with right now.
Yes.
And speaking that. You know, I was talking about my colleague. We lost those two people that I was talking about, the way our directors in the organization that I am in.
Yeah.
And I was just encouraging you after all this and say, you know what, everything is going to be fine. And we began to speak into the business and speak into the company.
Right.
That everything will fall into place. And I can say that we are moving, we are progressing.
Beyond
where we were in December, where we are now, we are actually progressing. And even beyond the, because we are part of a bigger group, beyond this, the entity that where I am stationed, within the group, I've had many conversations with the other senior management. And in the past 3 months, we've had serious conversations, meetings after meetings, sorting other things that we needed to sort out.
Right.
So I've been speaking that, you know what, unfinished business must be finished. And things that needs to be in order must come in. Yes.
So you... I like this. You did not just focus on yourself.
Yes.
You are focusing on your organization, which you don't own. You're a senior manager there. And you're saying, I add economic value. I'm seeing unfinished business here. And you begin to speak to the organization. And as you started those conversations, things started happening. And you know, this principle of speaking is very powerful. You know, there's a science that is taking the world by storm, where people are talking about narrative, they're talking about story, they're talking about the words you speak, that the organization, people begin to move towards the conversations they're having. There's some research that is has just been done where they're saying, you know what, even when we do our strategy sessions.
Yeah.
Most people are looking for what is wrong.
Yeah.
And the moment you say what is broken, what needs to be fixed, the moment you focus on that, you actually are weakened. But they're saying focus on the positive. They say, to use a big word, they say the organizations and people are heliotropic. They move towards the positive. They move towards the light.
Yeah.
So when we speak positive, when you inquire on organizations, you're going to focus on the strengths.
Yes.
You're going to focus on what are we good at? How can we make it better?
Yes.
Rather than say, what are we bad at? So words are powerful.
Absolutely.
So actually they say the conversations you have, your starting questions will shape your destiny.
Absolutely.
I mean, that is in academia.
Yes.
They're just catching up with the Bible.
Amen. Amen.
Yeah.
No, I'm seeing, you know, there are two things. You can either speak in your closet,
mm-hmm.
but there is also a place to speak in the context, in real terms,
right.
in the boardroom. And mm-hmm. and I think sometimes believers, we confine ourselves in speaking in the closet. And not speak into issues in the real world, in the boardrooms, mm-hmm. and where we are at.
Yeah.
And I think those, and that's what, where my challenge has been this mm-hmm. year, that yes, we can speak into things in the prayer closet, mm-hmm. but we also need to speak to things in reality when we have the conversations
yeah.
with the relevant people that we are dealing with.
And you have the authority, particularly if you are a certain level of influence in the organization. If you are managerial, what you speak in the closet,
yeah,
it help prepares you for what you speak in the boardroom.
Absolutely.
So if what you are saying in the boardroom is not consistent with what you are praying, then you are neutralizing mm-hmm. your prayer.
Absolutely.
So you need to give voice to your prayers
mm-hmm.
by beginning to engage, begin to direct conversation, because they are conversation shapers.
Yes.
In organizations, just like we are saying, talking about this this philosophy we are talking about, you need to shape conversations
mm.
by the way you speak, and begin to redirect the organization to a certain way of thinking, a certain way of seeing things. Because like we said, story and your conversations will determine your destiny. Absolutely. So we need to begin to do that, even in the marketplace.
Amen.
For this opportunity to share what He has done in our lives, and also to thank the people who rallied behind us during the most trying time of our lives. We just thank God for the selection, that there was a mighty army of prayer warriors surrounding us, speaking positively into our lives despite the circumstances. There is never a dull moment at home. We cannot believe our boy is more than 1 year old, and he's already fighting with the brothers. He switches off the TVs, he looks at us, he giggles, and you know, the bigger brothers, they feel like beating him up. But you know, that's just God. Who can say no when God has said yes? On the 2nd of March 2019, I'll never forget, I felt very sick at work. My blood pressure, it shot up the roof, and I had to be initiated treatment immediately at the hospital, and then I had to be rushed to my hospital to ICU. It will be a battle. I almost lost my sight, and the BP, it was uncontrollable. At one point, we thought we were winning the battle. Then the blood pressure, 2 weeks down the line, just decided to shoot up the roof. And I had to have an emergency cesarean section to save my life. Everyone was happy. The baby came out very strong, a whopping 1.365 grams. The pediatrician was quite happy. But men are the afflictions of the righteousness. We'll go through a most trial time in the neonatal ICU. My baby will have to fight the complications of prematurity, having zero immunity. He developed infections. He had feeding problems. He had chronic lung diseases, just to name the few. And then on that, there's this other infection, Klebsiella, that is the worst fear for every mother and every pediatrician. And my son, he got that infection 3 times, and on 3 episodes, he will collapse. He even had CPR where his heart stopped pumping, and people had to manually pump the heart. I remember even there was this other day when I even called for people that you have to suss CPR, and they came and they took me away. And then there was this sister who just comforted me and said, you know what, don't lose hope. Just remain looking at the Lord. The Lord will do it for you. Don't lose hope. And then after that, as if it wasn't enough, that infection, it went and sit in the heart and it developed a huge clot. And he had to have open heart surgery, and for the fourth time his heart is stopped. And after the operation, there were like 13 ribs that were connected to his body, a child with the size of the palm of my hand. But you know, God, being Yahweh and all powerful and mighty, he came through everything, you know. Then one day I went to the hospital with my friend to visit, and he was just crying uncontrollably. And then my friend just decided, why don't you hold the baby? And for the first time in 2.5 months, I hold the baby. Then 2 weeks after, I started breastfeeding for the first time. And then a week later, they gave me the child on oxygen. I have no words. I'm so grateful. You know, some of these things you cannot say thank you enough. I have so many people at work who supported us, people at my husband's work, and this medical aid who supported us, paid everything, no levy, no nothing. The people from church, the cell groups, you know, there were ladies who would just come and pray. You know, for that, you know, I'm so grateful. Thank you.
Few weeks back, and there's something that struck me.
Right.
We don't have time to go into much detail.
No, I'm all ears. Let's dig in. Let's get into this.
So we remember Haman's plot to have the Jews executed.
Right.
And he tricked the king to write the decree and to send it to the provinces. I think it's in Exodus chapter 3, verse 13. It says, "And the letters were sent by couriers into all the king's provinces to destroy, to kill, to annihilate all Jews, both young and old, little children, women, in one day, on the 13th day of the 12th month, which is the month of Adar, and to plunder their possessions." The thing that struck me, after everything, then Esther came into the picture,
right?
And he then spoke to the king, and he won favor of the king, and Haman was killed.
Yes.
But the story did not end there.
Right.
Why? Because the word was already gone to the
provinces. Yes, word had gone to the provinces, right?
The word was already gone to the provinces.
And it was a royal decree.
It was a royal decree. And after everything has happened to Haman, but the story is the Israelites are still in danger.
Yeah.
Because of a word that is
There's
already gone.
A decree
gone.
That is gone. It's operative.
It's already operative.
Yeah.
And we are talking of the page of the Medes, where they say that his word cannot be revoked.
Yeah.
Now we see Esther doing something which was very significant. He goes back to the king and say, "I cannot be happy because the word is out there and my people are going to perish."
Yeah.
And the king says, "You write a decree that you want in my name and send it." Now, I would expect that the decree would be whatever was said before, it has been cancelled.
It can, because the law of the Medes and the Persians says it's operative.
It's operative.
Yeah. So you need a superior.
So then Esther, the second decree that went out was to say, it was not to say that what was said is no longer operative.
Yeah.
That what was said was still operative.
Yeah.
But the second decree was saying, all the Jews and everyone, you have the right,
and you're empowered,
and you are empowered
to defend yourself.
To defend yourself.
No,
that got me thinking. You know, there are words that has already gone out.
Right.
There are words that we have been spoken already.
Right.
It could be me. We have spoken words to on my family, on my children. That word is already on myself.
Yeah.
Well, I'm better, and that word is operative. We cannot recall it.
Yeah.
But what we can do is to speak a superior word, to speak or to send a new word, a new decree that can. So we see in this story that there was actually clashes. People actually fought.
Yeah.
Because those were still carrying the old decree, and the Jews had the new decree.
Yeah.
And the Jews had to fight and defend their lives.
Yeah.
So which speaks to what we are talking about. That, you know, when the word is gone, it is gone. The demons are running with it.
Yes.
We need to then release a new word that the angels can run with it.
Yeah.
And defend us.
And I think that's a powerful insight to say, unless you do something with the word that has gone out, it's still operative.
Yes.
Now, the thank God because of Jesus and because of his blood shed on the cross, we can neutralize even the word that has gone out. The word that you spoke mistakenly, if you come into repentance and you call on the blood of Jesus, it's neutralized because the blood of Jesus speaks better things.
Yes.
So when you have that, that's how you operationalize.
Yes.
We are not necessarily going to go like the Jews yet where they had to now fight, these ones are fighting this and this. You can neutralize.
Yes.
But we still need to act.
Yes.
To render null and void that word.
Yes.
And here is the thing among Africans that we need to understand.
Yeah.
You see, there is a word that you speak. And Pastor Tom led us in and he gave a prayer of repentance where we should neutralize the words you have spoken against others, spoken against ourselves.
Yes.
And I think that's important. We probably need to deal with that today as well.
Yes. Yes.
But there is also something that a lot of African believers struggle with.
Mm.
You see, because of the spiritual nature of our African culture, you see, our names are invoked and they are mentioned in demonic practices.
Mm.
So you find that though you may not be present if your family is not born again.
Yeah.
When they worship ancestors and they invoke those spirits, they mention your name, they say, be with those who are not even here.
Yeah.
And then now we as believers, we hear about it and we just ignore it.
Mm.
But those words are operative because they're giving license to the demonic to operate in your life. Sometimes you are hitting the snake and they even break. They say, that child, they went away, don't worry. We deal with it here at the commotion. And they'll come back. You see, they'll come and apologize.
Yes.
And sometimes you begin to have all these problems.
Yes.
But you see, the Bible says the blood of Jesus speaks better things than the blood of Abel.
Yes.
So as a believer, knowingly or unknowingly, that if your family is not born again, they will invoke your name, they will speak words that can bind you.
Yes.
So once in a while, we must take that time to say, I neutralize every word that is contrary to the word of God. Every word that has been spoken over my life, spoken towards me, that is not in alignment with the word, I neutralize. So that's the second decree that Esther did.
Yes.
When she neutralizes the first, and she then invokes a more powerful word.
Amen. So what I was seeing in this is that the king is already reversed, or is already dealt with Haman.
Yeah.
The matter is dealt with already.
Mm-hmm.
Which means the victory has already been granted.
Yeah.
But it still required us to
follow up action.
Follow up action.
To deal with the consequences.
To deal with the consequences. It is still required a decree to be sent for.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I think that's what Pastor was saying, that it's a year of God's favor.
Yeah.
But we will still be required to speak.
Yeah. So it's important for us to speak. Do not be silent where you're supposed to speak.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And the other story of the story of Daniel and the Babylonian captivity also was ministering to me in the same vein, you know, that we hear that, yes, they were sent into Babylon under captivity.
Mm-hmm.
Now we come to the book of Daniel. Mm-hmm. Daniel now realizes or meets, or he reads about the prophecy that Jeremiah had given
to say that after 70 years, the captivity will be for 7 years, then they will
go. I'm sure also Daniel also read Isaiah 45 about the king Cyrus.
Yes.
Yeah. And with that knowledge, he began to engage God.
Yeah.
Say, it is almost 70 years.
Yeah.
It was already spoken by Jeremiah.
Mm-hmm.
And he sees Cyrus coming into the picture.
Mm-hmm.
And we see now Daniel seeking the Lord.
Right.
So which, for me, it God had already planned.
Right.
I believe the Isaiah prophesied about Cyrus. I think it was more than 150 years before Cyrus.
200 years, yes, you're right. Before he was even born.
Which means that there are things that God has already given us.
Yeah.
There are things, there are businesses that God has already planned for us.
Yeah.
There are things that God has already given us. But although they have been given to us, we still need to speak.
We need to activate them.
We need to activate by words.
You see, we go back to the principle that we are created or we are made.
Yeah.
We are partakers of the divine nature.
Mm.
The divine nature is that God is a king. He is a creator. Mm. He creates by a royal decree.
Yes.
He speaks. He says, let there be.
Yes.
And it was.
Yes.
And the Bible says in Corinthians, it says, we having the same spirit of faith, we believe, therefore we speak.
Yes.
So we need to speak to create situations we want.
Amen.
We need to get into the things that God has spoken to you.
Yes.
In secret.
Yes.
They need to be given voice.
Yes.
The things that he has spoken about in your way, in the word.
Mm.
Just like in this issue. He has already made a decree. There will be Cyrus.
Yes.
You will shepherd my people.
Yes.
But God needed a human vessel.
Yes.
That will give voice to that word.
Yes.
And that's where we come in.
Yes.
That's what you're saying.
Yes.
Yes, go for it.
Amen. So, for me, I was talking about the end of Ayin and what God has been showing me.
Yes.
God has shown me many things that are yet to be accomplished in my life.
Right.
And so, yes, every one of us, as we continue to seek God, the Holy Spirit begins to reveal the things that we need to do, the things that have already been done for us.
Yeah.
And our role in this is for us then to begin to speak it forth,
right.
To begin to speak it, not only in the prayer closet, but also in the marketplace.
Yes.
We begin to make some actions and begin to speak into situations,
right.
That brings us to a place where the business is finally there. It's so there on paper, it's registered,
yeah.
And we have offices and everything is happening.
Right.
But it has to start from a place of speaking it.
So do you need to speak?
Absolutely.
Right.
Absolutely.
Beautiful.
So
great insight right there.
Thank you, Doc. So I just want to encourage someone this morning, this evening, that, you know, yes, the Lord has been showing you this thing for many years. And you know what he has been saying? Where do I start? This is your starting point. Begin to speak it. And as we continue to speak it, we begin to gather faith. We begin to, you know, sometimes we, let me just give you an example. They say that courage is not the absence of fear.
Right.
But you are faced with a fearful situation.
Mm-hmm.
Courage then is to say, despite of the fearfulness of this thing, but I know that God is with me. And you begin to speak.
So I feel the fear, but I do it anyway.
I do it anyway.
So courage is strength in adversity. Moving on despite the fear.
Despite the fear, yes.
Mm-hmm.
So what I wanted to say is that, yes, it may look like that this thing, how am I going to get there?
Mm.
What am I going to do? And it looks like a mountain.
Right.
But as you begin to speak, you are kind of encouraging yourself.
Right.
And that encouraging yourself builds the faith in you that you would need for you to take the next step.
Right.
So this speaking is really, really very important in terms of it becomes kind of an affirmation to you. And then as you continue to affirm yourself in the thing, then you then move from a place of affirmation to a place of decreeing things. Now you are in faith.
So what you're saying, Pastor, is when you see something in the Word, your starting point is to speak it.
Yes.
First to yourself.
Yes.
Whether in your prayer, whether it's an affirmation, whether it's whatever.
Yes.
And you're building yourself up.
Yes.
You are making that Word a reality in you.
Yes.
Before you speak it out there.
Yes.
Because sometimes there is a disobedience where somebody is speaking the Word, but they actually don't believe it. Inside they're saying, I don't even know whether this will work. So you need to be fully persuaded. You need that Word to work in you.
Yes.
Before it works for you.
Yes.
So by speaking the Word,
yes,
to yourself,
yes,
praying through that word,
yes,
is really bringing you to a place of conviction to be fully persuaded.
Yes.
So that when you make, when you now make the decree, it's not just a vain repetition, mm-hmm. or it's not just a vain talk.
Yes.
It's speaking from a position of power and authority.
Yes.
So that's the link between affirmation. When it becomes a reality in you,
yes,
you encourage yourself to strengthen yourself. It builds your faith.
Yes.
A faith comes by hearing the word of God.
Yes.
So faith comes even to you by you hearing the word of God that in your own mouth.
Yes.
As I speak the word.
Yes.
As I affirm it.
Yes.
Faith rises up.
Yes.
Then from a position of faith, I make a decree to, yes, circumstances, to situation, to principalities and to powers.
Amen.
That's powerful.
Amen. Amen. So, saints, that's the season where we are in, where God is revealing to us. I think Pastor Tom in his word says, what we were experiencing in the season, in the decade of Ayin, where the Holy Spirit is revealing things to us, is revealing the truth, the word to us. He is continuing doing it even in this season. And as he continues to do that in this season, let us begin to see what God has already done.
Amen.
Let us begin to see what God is doing.
Hallelujah.
And begin and continue to speak it.
Yes.
There's one aspect, Doug, which, yeah, I believe is very, very important, which is related to this.
Yes, go for it.
Pastor Tom was teaching us in terms of watching this word, guarding this word.
Right.
Because there is an adversary who does not want this to come to pass.
True.
So in his word, he says, guard is the Hebrew word sama, which means to watch.
Mm-hmm.
Sama speaks to the calling forth of the watchman to guard and watch over the purposes of God.
Right.
As decrees are made and the creative force of God is loosed, there will be a shift, mm-hmm. a new beginning, a new birth.
Right.
In places and in situations where they had once been death and decay, I believe that this verse is a call for the watchman to watch over, to contend for, and to keep the delivery of the new things on course, so that what God is releasing is not dismantled by the schemes of the enemy.
Right.
For me, that it hit me.
Mm-hmm.
You say God is doing things.
Right.
But if you and I do not stand as watchmen,
mm-hmm.
and guard these things, it will be released, but it will never come to pass,
yeah.
in reality in our lives.
Right.
And and that took me to the word of God in the book of Isaiah, chapter 56, which says, from verse 9, it says, all you beasts of the fields, come to devour. All you beasts of the forest, his watchmen are blind.
Mm.
They are all ignorant. They are all dumb dogs. They cannot bark.
Oh,
sleeping, lie around, loving to slumber. Yes, they are greedy dogs, which never have enough, and they are shepherds who cannot understand. They all look to their own way, everyone for his own gain.
Lord have mercy.
So, this struck me in saying that, yes, God is doing things,
right,
for us in our ministry. God is doing things for us in our lives. God is doing things for us in our businesses.
Right.
He is releasing things.
Yes.
He is releasing breakthroughs.
Mm-hmm.
He is releasing what we need for our lives.
Mm-hmm.
But if we do not guard,
yeah,
these things, there is a devourer.
So we need to guard, we need to watch over, we need to contend.
Yes.
Because whatever God speaks, the enemy will want to try and undo.
Yes.
You remember the moment God has spoken that in the fullness of time, the virgin will give birth,
yes,
Messiah will come.
Yes.
And in the meanwhile, the devourer is on the sprawl.
Yes.
All throughout redemption history,
yes,
he is trying to undo that word.
Yes.
So whenever God speaks a word,
yes,
the enemy is trying to undo that,
yes,
word.
Yes.
So this is what we have been called to be, watchmen, to steward,
yes,
the word that God has spoken.
Yes.
To contend for it.
Yes.
So that those things will come to pass.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So many breakthroughs were given, but those breakthroughs never came to reality because we fall to a place where, you know what, no, if God has given us, he has given us. Yes, he has given us.
It's almost a fatalistic approach, like the Muslims would put, inshallah.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever will be, will be.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a resignation to fate.
Yes.
But God is saying, no, I don't want you to resign to fate. Mm-hmm. The fact that I've spoken it, the fact that I've promised it, you still need to contend it. You are stewards over it.
Yes.
You contend to protect that which I've spoken.
Yes.
Until it comes to manifestation.
Yes. Mm-hmm. No, I think that's when we read the book of Daniel, we hear the Bible tells us that from the day you began to speak these things,
mm-hmm.
the answer was dispatched.
Yeah.
But when one day is later, the answer is not yet delivered.
Yes. You have to watch and contend.
You have to watch and contend. So we see Daniel in prayer and fasting. And then the angel eventually comes and say, hey, mm-hmm. from the very day you started,
I was on my way. But I had a contestation.
the
prince of Greece and the principalities here were contesting. So that's what it says. We need to watch.
Mm.
And I think he goes on to say that the decrees carry the message.
Yes.
But the establishment must come from active stewardship.
Yes.
Our watching over the word.
Yes.
In other words, we need to actively engage the process of bringing the word of God to deliver.
Yes.
So the word that child of God you've been given, don't just sit on it.
Mm.
But steward that word. Actively engage. Mm. Actively pursue. Actively improve yourself. Actively do certain things. There are things that God expects us to do. We watch in prayer.
Yes.
But we watch as we also open our eyes to see.
Yes.
What the doors which God is opening.
Yes. Mm. Now, Doc, a few weeks back, we engaged in prayer and fasting.
Mm.
Which you challenged us to do. And it was such a blessing for me when we engaged in the prayer and fasting.
Mm.
Because in there, you know, I then realized that, you know what, I might have been sleeping on some things.
Mm.
Busy doing this, but there are some areas where which are neglected.
Mm-hmm.
So, which brings us back to the issue of watching over.
Yeah.
There are things that God has instructed us to do this year. There are things that God has given us this year.
Mm-hmm.
But when we lose that place where we continuously engage Him in prayer,
right.
or in fasting,
mm-hmm.
then things go the other way.
Yeah.
And then we wonder at the end of the day, what happened? But what really happened is that we moved away from the place of guarding
mm-hmm.
the word, or guarding what the instruction, or guarding what God is given us already, or the breakthroughs that He's given us already.
Mm.
So I was really blessed and challenged during the prayer, with the time we were praying and fasting.
7 days of prayer and fasting.
Yes, the days that we had in prayer and fasting. And
would you want to talk to us on, I think this is something critical that you are raising, Pastor. Mm. The issue of guarding, stewarding.
Yes.
The delivery of the word of God.
Mm.
Would you want to give us probably a personal example
mm.
of something that you probably were, you talked about, I was beginning to sleep on some things.
Mm.
Is it, you want to talk to us about something that God activated and you said, wait a minute, I'm becoming irresponsible. Mm. Now I need to be responsible for this thing, and you started to do it.
Yes, so there are a few things, Doc, that I can share, both professionally and also in ministry.
No, we love stories. Go for it. That's why we're here. This is a conversation. We want to draw some insights from your the reflections.
So I did mention earlier that, you know what, when the year began, we began to engage things and speak into situations in my organization.
Right.
And there was a time where, you know what, I'll say, ish, you know what, I give up. This thing is not resolved, or it's not getting resolved.
Mm.
But when we were praying and fasting 3 weeks ago,
mm-hmm.
I felt a new energy to say, you know what,
mm-hmm.
I think I'm forgetting the scripture where Paul writes, is it to Titus, where he says, I've left you there to put in order. Preach,
to put things in order, yeah.
To put things in order.
Yes, Titus 1, yeah.
Yes, and that scripture came back to me in mm-hmm. saying that, but don't you realize that maybe you are right here in this place and in this organization to get things in order.
Right.
But now you are just about to just to leave it and to give up, and
you are not stewarding.
Yes.
And this requires active stewardship.
Yes. Could it be that that's you have left, or rather you what has challenged you at the beginning of the year, you are now saying, I'm tired, you know. So sometimes when we continue pushing things but we are not engaging with God, then we lose the power and the energy to continue pursuing something.
Right.
So that's what I saw in that circumstance. And the second,
so what's happening now? Are you now actively engaged with those
processes? We are actively engaging with those
on processes. The ball.
We are the eyes on the ball.
Excellent.
We are pushing, and I'm seeing that we are getting somewhere.
Praise God. May God give you the grace to complete.
Amen. And then the second aspect.
Sorry. Yeah. Just me. You know, that's the beauty of having me in these conversations. You know, not only may God give you the grace, but may God give you favor, and may He open the ears,
amen,
of the decision makers. May your voice be amplified, so that when you speak, as you help create order,
yes,
may you not have to fight for your voice to be heard.
Amen.
May your voice become so powerful in the organization.
Amen. I receive that, Doc. Thank you so much.
Amen.
So I was going to mention the second aspect.
Yes, you go ahead.
The second aspect being,
we have 10 minutes now, so go ahead.
The second aspect being, you know, this year has been the busiest year I've ever had in my life.
Okay.
With work, there are so many projects that we were doing, and that has kept us so busy.
Right.
And I was just now reflecting on my family, and of course, because of this lockdown, I was just reflecting on my family in terms of my children and how I engage with them, my role as a priest in the house.
Right.
And I could see that it's an area that I kind of partially deserted. As I was just focusing on doing things at our office and doing things at our career,
right,
and the same applies to some of the things that I needed to do in the ministry. I was so busy with the things of my career, and some of the things in the ministry were lagging behind. And as you were praying and fasting, something that just challenged me that, you know what, we have a mandate. Yes, we've got a mandate in the marketplace, but we do have a mandate in the body of Christ, in the church of God, to serve.
You're a bivocational minister, so you have to war with both hands.
Absolutely. So those are the things that I began to see for myself, but I was really encouraged and energized, and to know that, yes, I have a part to play in all these aspects,
right,
and God is going to see me through.
Hallelujah. You will. You will.
Amen.
You will. Wow. What's some profound insight?
Thank you. Thank you, Doc.
I think this conversation about the power of words, we want to take some time to minister, pastor, to somebody who is under conviction right now. You know that you either were flippant with your words, you believed the lie of the devil about your family, about your marriage, about your workplace, about your children, and you started giving voice to the words of the enemy. Mm-hmm. And by doing that, like you said, you are activating, you are adding fuel to the demonic to destroy. So you like to minister to somebody, help them pray to break and silence. Remember, you told us about Esther's decree.
Yes.
That there was a decree that has gone out. So the words that people have spoken,
yes,
whether about others, about themselves, they are operational.
Yes.
So help them annul and cancel that by the power of the blood.
Amen.
And operate and create a new decree.
Yes.
That begins to supersede. Would you look into the camera and just minister to somebody and help them come to that point where that they are no longer in condemnation, because the devil would want to condemn them for the words they have spoken or the words that have been spoken about them, but lead them to release.
Amen. Thank you, Doc. And I was just thinking, Doc, in the word of the year, Pastor Tom led us into a prayer.
Right.
And I'm feeling that, I'm feeling that maybe this prayer can help us right now, if we can pray this prayer again.
Right.
And I think in the word of the year, Pastor Tom said, let's come back to this prayer again and again, and pray it as it relates to the words that we have spoken in the past, the words that were spoken against us. So if, please just, let's just join together and praying this prayer again. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father.
Heavenly Father.
Forgive me for the careless words that I've spoken over the last decade.
Forgive me for the careless words that I've spoken over the last decade.
Forgive me for the things that I've said about myself.
Forgive me for the things that I've said about myself.
That were not in line with your plan for my life.
That were not in line with my, your plan for my life.
I repent for using the anointing you have given me to speak falsehood.
I repent for using the anointing you gave me to speak falsehoods.
Based on peer pressure.
Based on peer pressure.
Culture and my generation.
Culture and my generation.
Forgive me for the things I have spoken over my children.
Forgive me, Lord, for the things I have spoken over my children.
My spouse, my family, and friends.
Over my spouse, my family, and my friends.
That were not part of your plan for their lives.
That are not part of your plan for their lives.
Forgive me for giving voice to what is evil.
Forgive me for giving voice to what is evil.
Instead of what is good.
Instead of what is good.
Purify my heart and mind.
Lord, purify my heart and mind.
I pray the fire of the Holy Ghost will cleanse my tongue.
I pray that the fire of the Holy Ghost cleanses my tongue.
And cause me to speak your words, not my opinions.
And cause me to speak your words and not my opinion.
Renew my mind with your word.
Renew my mind, Lord, with your word.
Renew my mind with your word. Let's take this again. Renew my mind with your word.
Renew my mind with your word.
So that only your words flow from my mouth.
So that only your word flows through my mouth.
I pray the Holy Spirit makes me aware.
I pray the Holy Spirit makes me aware.
When I'm about to say something that is not your will.
When I'm about to say something that is not your will.
According to Psalm 141 verse 3.
According to Psalm 141 verse 3.
Put a guard over my mouth.
Lord, put a guard over my mouth.
And set watch over the doors of my lips.
And set watch over the doors of my lips.
Bring a heavy conviction over me.
Bring, Lord, a heavy conviction over me.
When I'm getting ready to say the wrong thing.
When I'm about to say the wrong thing.
Let me quickly be repentant and make it right.
Let me be quickly repentant and make it right.
Now I pray that you cancel every evil declaration.
Father, I pray that you cancel, you annul every evil declaration.
That I've released into the atmosphere.
That I have spoken into the atmosphere.
I do not want to eat the fruit of the death from my lips.
I don't want to eat the fruit of death from my lips.
I pray these words come to nothing.
I pray that all those words will come to nothing.
Cause my mind to reflect on things that are true.
Cause my mind to reflect on things that are true.
Things that are pure, lovely, and praiseworthy.
Things that are pure, true, lovely, and praiseworthy.
Things that are good, uplifting, honest, and peaceful.
Things that are good, lovely, honest, and peaceful.
Give me a new mindset.
Give me a new mindset, Lord.
Your mindset.
Your mindset.
With so much bad in this world.
With so much bad in this world.
Let me see the positive in all situations.
Let me see the positive in all situations.
And speak that instead of what is negative.
And speak that instead of what is negative.
I trust you, Holy Spirit.
I trust you, Holy Spirit.
To keep me accountable.
To keep me accountable.
In Jesus' name, amen.
In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
Saints, we are going to, if you do not have a copy of the Word of the Year, we are going to circulate again to you on our platforms. Come back to this prayer again and again, and may God release you from, I know the God has already released you from every word, every vile word that you have spoken on your children, on your spouse, on your business, on your friends, or anyone in your family. Our God is good. Hallelujah. The Bible tells us that they who overcame him, they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony.
Amen.
Thank you, Father, for the blood of Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord, for the
Thank
blood
you,
that was shed
Thank
that
you,
speaks
Jesus.
Better. Thank
yes.
you that the blood of Abel.
Jesus name.
Father, we thank you
Hallelujah.
In the name of Jesus
thank
that
you,
the
Jesus.
Blood of Jesus represents
Hallelujah.
Us in the heavenly court and
Jesus.
Speaks of us in a
thank
better
you,
light. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, and every word that we had spoken, every
thank
word
you,
that was spoken
Jesus.
Against us, it has no
Jesus.
Power. It has
yes,
no room of our
Jesus.
Lives. Father, we
thank
you for what
you
are doing in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Father, we thank you. Our children have been released from the words spoken. Our businesses have been released from the words spoken. Our ministry has been released from the words spoken. Father, we thank you and we honor your name. For you are God and there's no one like you. In Jesus' mighty name, hallelujah.
Amen and amen.
Bless God.
Thank you so much, Pastor. Bless you. It's so good talking to you. And I really learned a lot. And I gleaned a lot of insights. And from these reflections, our words are powerful.
Amen.
But there are also words that have been operational, that have been spoken. And I want to challenge you as a believer. Just like Esther, don't be satisfied. Don't settle. But pursue complete restoration.
Yes.
Begin to deal with those words that have been spoken. You have dealt with the words that you spoke, but you also need to deal with the words where your name is being mentioned on
yes.
demonic altars.
Yes.
You silence them and begin to release the word of God instead. Remember, the word says we should actively steward and guard and watch what God is doing. Let's begin to speak that in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Father, we thank you in the name of Jesus that right now we annul, we cancel every
yes,
word
Lord.
That has been spoken over your people
yes, Lord.
That are not of you.
Yes.
Father, those words which have been operational, we silence them, we annul
yes.
them by the blood of Jesus.
Yes.
Father, every word that has been spoken over the church,
yes.
the Celebration Church, Johannesburg, that are not of you, that are operational, that are destructive,
yes,
that
Lord.
Are releasing death, we cancel them, we render them powerless. In the name of Jesus, we say the blood of Jesus speaks better things. Things that have been spoken,
yes.
Father, in the name of Jesus about the Church of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Father, both the Celebration Ministers International, the Church of Jesus Christ, as the body of Christ worldwide. Father, we
yes,
cancel, we render powerless those words. And we
yes,
declare,
Lord.
We watch over the word of God. We say the church is alive.
Yes.
The church is triumphant. The church is victorious.
Yes.
Father, we cancel even
yes.
every negative word that has been
Hallelujah.
Spoken over the nation of South Africa.
Hallelujah.
That has given demonic powers
yes.
room.
Yes.
We cancel those words. And we say it is well with the righteous.
Yes.
It is well with South Africa.
Yes.
We say the kingdom of God is
yes.
forcefully advancing
yes.
in the nation of South Africa.
Yes.
And South Africa is yielding to the culture
yes.
of the kingdom of God.
Hallelujah.
We speak it, we declare it,
yes.
it is so. It
yes.
cannot be otherwise.
Hallelujah.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor.
Thank you so much, Pastor.
It's been great talking to you. I look forward to having you again in this conversation. So, church, thank you so much. God bless you. May God refresh you. May He water you as you become doers of the word. As you speak what you're supposed to speak. And we see you again next week in conversation right here at Celebration Powers. Thank you. God bless you. See you next week. Amen.
Amen.